إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, and that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last and final messenger sent to humanity. O you who believe, I remind you and I remind myself to have taqwa of Allah. What does taqwa mean? Taqwa means to have a balance between hope of Allah's mercy and fear in His punishment, and do not die except in a state of complete submission to Allah, except in a state of Islam. Now we know we're going to be tested. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that very clear in many parts of the Quran, such as when He said, بَعَدَ عَوْذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people really think that they just get to say, I'm Muslim, I said the kalima, and there's never going to be any tests? That life is just going to be smooth? There's not going to be any bumps in the road? No, it doesn't work like that. There's going to be many tests, and there's going to be many tribulations. Now, when I ask the average Muslim, what does it mean to be tested? I'm going to get pretty much the same standard answer. So somebody's going to say, being tested means losing my job. Somebody's going to say, being tested means being afflicted with a disease. Somebody's going to say, being tested means, you know, losing my job, or dealing with the death of a loved one. Okay, which is all true. After all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself said, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. That we are going to test you. Without doubt, we're going to test you. And we're going to test you with fear, with hunger, with loss of wealth, loss of life, loss of property. So this is all true. However, there's something else we're going to be tested in. And I think most of us have not even bothered to think about this. And that is that you and I, we will be tested and asked about the blessings that we enjoy. The delights, the pleasures, the comforts, the ease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says right at the end of Surah At-Takathur, which is a surah that almost everybody here has memorized, He says, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. He says, verily, you will be asked about the na'im that you enjoyed. Na'im here is abundance of blessing. It doesn't just mean blessings. And this is what we're going to talk about today. How do we handle all the blessings that we have? Because this is, I would argue, if not the greatest, one of the greatest tests for us living in the West here. How do we deal with all of the comforts and luxuries that we have at our disposal? Because how we deal with them is going to determine our success in the next life. You see here, when we want a car, it's not a matter of what kind of car or how big is the car going to be. It's what kind of car am I going to get. It's not a matter of whether am I going to have a roof over my head. It's a matter of how big a house can I get. We don't worry about are we going to eat three meals a day. We don't worry about that. For us, it's what kind of food are we going to eat and where are we going to go eat it. This is what we deal with. And on a side note, by the way, somebody asked us and said, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He tests those who He loves the most. So the most tested are those who are the most beloved, who are who? The Anbiya, the Prophets, and then the Salihin, the righteous, and so on and so forth. So He said, I don't understand. He said, I have a nice job, I have a nice car, I live in a nice neighborhood, my kids go to a nice school. Where is my test? Well, here's your answer. This is your test. Your test is how do you handle all of these luxuries and all of these goods that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Because how we handle them will determine our success in the next life. Now we got to put a couple notions aside though before we continue. Having comfort or luxury is not necessarily a bad thing. One of the first du'as we learn is what? رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh Allah, give us good in this life and the next life and save us from the fire. So we ask for good in this life. Nobody says, oh Allah, let me have difficulty in providing for my family. Oh Allah, do not give me transportation so my life is difficult. Nobody makes that dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us this dua. Ask for good in this life. Okay, so think about it like this. Here is Jannah over here. And here is a body of water. So this body of water, this is the dunya. And the ship, this is us. Now, in order to get to Jannah, you have to go through the water. Because a ship without water is useless. See, you have to go through the dunya. So likewise, we have to go through the dunya. But the key is when we're going through the water or the dunya, okay, maybe a hole will come in the ship. And then we make istighfar. The problem comes is when we get so many holes in the ship, and then we are drowned in the dunya, and we go under. So that's what we're trying to avoid. That is what we're trying to avoid. It doesn't mean that we can't have nice things, but that's not the goal. The goal is not just to hoard. The goal is not just to acquire material wealth. You know, some of you may have seen this bumper sticker. It says, whoever dies with the most toys wins. You know, what do they win? The Muslim version, you know, would be like, whoever dies with the most toys still dies. Because you can't take it with you. Like this oil tycoon who died a few years back, he was buried in his Cadillac. He said, this is my wish. And his $10,000 suit. That's not going to help his soul, right? So it's just that, where is the limit? It's not our only goal. Okay, the second thing, this is very, very important, especially for us living here. Many times we tend to think that we have the best of everything. We have the best home, we have the best jobs, we have the best businesses. We have to realize and humble ourselves and know that sometimes the blessings we think that we enjoy are an absolute curse for other people. They don't want those blessings. So I'll give you a generic example. And I don't care whether this is you're in Cairo or you're in Karachi or you've seen this on TV or you've read about it. It's the same example. You go to the Muslim world, you're going to find a shopkeeper. And he's going to have a very small, humble shop. And he's going to sell goods. And what's going to happen when the time for prayer comes? He's going to lock up his shop and he's going to go and pray in Jama'ah. And he's going to do that 5 times a day. Now, when we look at it from our perspective, we're going to say, what are you doing? You know, you got to expand. This product is selling a lot, you got to stock up more. So that means you got to get a bigger place. And then maybe you should think about moving your business down to the road where people can see it more. That's how we're thinking, because that's what we define as success. You know what he's going to say? He's going to say, no, thank you. You can keep your definition of success. He says, you know what I have? What I have is I don't have a 2-hour commute to my work. I don't pay a ridiculous amount of rent for my business. I'm not drowned in debt for the next 20 years. So you can take your concept of success and keep it. No, thank you. He says, I'm actually richer than you because I'm praying all of my prayers in Jama'ah, in the masjid. So this is something we need to keep in mind, that just because of what we have is not always the best. Now, there's a very, but I mean, the more we have, the more we're going to be asked about. It's simple as that. But it's not just material blessings. So safety. Safety is a blessing. Yes, we have some issues with anti-Islamic sentiment, but almost everybody, you don't worry when you step out of your house about your safety. Now, when I talk to my aunt who doesn't live here, you know what she says? She says, I just make dua that when my children leave for school, they come back. That's what I do. That's my dua. We don't have to deal with that, but these are all comforts that we enjoy, and Allah will ask us what we did with them. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a hadith that very powerfully illustrates this point. So he is walking. He's walking and he sees Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma. And he says, because it was an awkward hour, so he says, you know, what are you doing here at this hour? What made you come out of your homes? And they say, al-jur. In other words, hunger. They say, we're hungry. That's why we're here. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he says, you know, the same thing that brought you out is what brought me out. In other words, I'm hungry too. So they say, okay, let's go to Fulan's house, whose name is not mentioned in this particular narration. So they're walking, and they walk to his house. And the wife receives them and says, he's not here, he went to fetch us some water from the well. So they say, okay. Now in the meantime, the man in the distance, he sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma. He sees them, and he is overjoyed. And why wouldn't he be, right? And he says, nobody has greater guests than I have today. First of all, he has two of the rightly guided khalifas, and he has rahmatul lil alameen, he has the mercy of mankind sent to him. So of course, nobody's going to have better guests. So he rushes in, and he hangs up his little bucket he had for fetching water from the well. He hangs it on a tree, he climbs up the tree, and he gets a handful of dates. And he brings them to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, eat these. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he says, you know, you choose them. He said, no, you choose. As if to basically say, like, take the best ones. And then he takes a blade, and he slaughters a sheep. And he slaughters a sheep, and then they all eat until they are filled. And then this is the really serious part. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says to Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma, he says, these are the blessings that you will be asked about. These are the na'im. This is because you came here and you were hungry. And now you're leaving and now you're full. Now you're satisfied. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you about this. Now, what about us then? You know, with our selection of food and comforts and all of this in general. So how do we handle this? Inshallah, we will discuss this in the second khutbah. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما صلى الله عليه وسلم. So we have these comforts and luxuries. What do we do now? Do we sit around and get depressed? Do we say that, oh, Allah gave us everything in this life, we've got no chance now at the afterlife? No, that's not what Islam teaches us. How do we handle them? That is the key. So what are a couple of things we can do? Number one, what is the reaction when you got the blessing? So when you got the new job, did you say the first thing you said, Alhamdulillah? Or maybe, you know, you jumped up and did a little celebration dance, or maybe you pumped your fist, you know, and then later you said, Alhamdulillah. When you got the new house, did you tell your family, you know, let's read 2 rak'ah to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or was it, oh, let's go to dinner, and then, you know, maybe 3 hours later, if you remembered, you said, Alhamdulillah. When you saw somebody else had a blessing, did you say, MashaAllah, Barakallahu fi? Or did you say, why did they have to get it? Did you get jealous? You say, I deserve it more than he does. Why do they have it? How we respond to the blessing will make the reckoning easier for us. So if we are grateful in the beginning, then Allah will see that we are tracing everything back to Him. We are tracing everything back to Him. It wasn't through our own doing. Allah gave it to us and we are happy. And then inshallah, the reckoning will be easy. Just like when you go to a traffic court. Okay, you're all good drivers, mashallah, so you've never been, of course. But when you go to traffic court, everybody wants the easy judge. So you'll go to one judge, and he'll come in and he won't let anybody off. Even if you have a valid excuse, even if it wasn't really your fault, even if you bring the best evidence, he'll say, nobody gets off. Now on another day, you'll go and you'll get a judge. And this judge will say, I'm kind of tired today. Everybody's free to go. So when we're in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want this judgment, the easy reckoning, you know, so that it just goes by quickly and we don't have to be called to account. Secondly, what can we do? We can use the blessing we have to spread the blessings. Now, what do I mean by that? That doesn't just, of course it means if you have wealth, you spend it on others. Yes, that's part of it. But think outside the box a little bit. Use the blessing that you have to acquire other blessings. So, you have a nice car. What was the intention behind that car? Was it so it becomes your status symbol? Was it to pick up the other gender? Was it so everybody sees, look at me, look at what I'm driving? Was that the intention? If it is, then you'll get what you intended. However, what if you took that nice car, and with that nice car, you came once a day to the masjid? And with that nice car, you took your children to Islamic class. And with that nice car, you went to work where you earned a halal income, and then you came back and spent on your family. Now, when Allah says, I gave you this nice car, what did you do with it? You will say, Allah, I used it in ta'ah. I used it in your obedience, not in your disobedience. And then, inshallah, the reckoning will be easier. And then the third thing that we can do is to follow the advice of the Prophet ﷺ when he's telling us about people of the dunya, and he says, "Unzuru ila man huwa asfala minkum, wa la tanzuru ila man huwa fawqakum." He said, when you're looking at people in this world, you look at who is below you. You don't look at who's above you. Because if you do that, you may degrade the blessings that you already have. Because if you're looking at people below you, then you're going to say, you know what, alhamdulillah, you know, my boss is a jerk, but at least I have a job. This person doesn't have a job. Or this person lives in a rough neighborhood. Or this person has a tough life. So you'll always appreciate and you'll always be thankful for what you have. Now, on the other hand, if you're looking at people who are above you, if you're looking at people who are above you, there's no limit to that. There's no end. Somebody's always going to have a nicer job. They're always going to have a nicer car. They're always going to be better looking than you are. They're always going to have blessings that you don't have. So you can't focus on that. Because if you focus on that, then you lose sight of the big picture. So I'll give you two real life examples. There's two doctors. Okay, and I'm not making this up. There's two doctors. So one of them was extremely wealthy. Now, if we look, if we're just looking at people who have more than us in the dunya, we're going to look and say, man, that person had it made. This doctor had 7 Ferraris. 7. So they asked him, why do you have 7? He said, oh, one for every day of the week, of course. Okay? So he had 7. And he said, but let me tell you something else. He said, I have no relationship whatsoever with my children. He said, my son leaves the house, I don't even know where he is. He comes back after 2 days, 3 days, I don't know who he's with, I don't know what he's doing, I don't know where he went. And my daughter, we don't even speak to each other. Now we're in the same house, this massive house, I don't know who's home, who isn't home. I have no relationship. Now we look from a distance, we say, wow, this person has so much. They have nothing in reality. Now, another family member of mine, this person wasn't in my family, by the way. Another family member of mine, he was put in charge of about 7 or 8 hospitals, a very big, very prestigious position. And he was 25 years younger than everybody else. You know, this is a position, it takes your whole life to get to, and he got it in such a young age. And you know what he did after about 6 months? He said, forget it. I'm leaving this position. Why did he leave it? Because he said, I don't spend any time with my kids. And he had young children. So this person, he gets it. Because we would look and say, what are you doing, you fool? You're leaving this position? People work their whole life to get to this position. And he said, no, because my relationship with my children is far more important. So again, we look at the distance. We look from a distance. If we're looking always at people who are above us in the dunya, then we're never going to be satisfied. Which leads to a beautiful principle. If you can establish this one thing in your life, then you'll never be down. And that is the principle of contentment. Contentment is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now, let me clarify. Contentment does not mean that you're lazy. It doesn't mean you don't have any ambition, like many people, you know, erroneously believe. No. It just means that whatever Allah decreed, you did your best, and you accept whatever is there. You accept it. Now, I know that's weird for us to hear living in America, because we don't have contentment is like against our culture. We're a consumer culture. You know how much money the average American saves? -0.5%. In other words, we don't save any money because it's always about getting more. It's always about You know, how can I get bigger things and better things? If something costs, you know, I laugh when I hear these so-called financial experts, how to get out of debt, how to be happier. And they'll say things like, if something costs $500 and you have $300, you don't buy it. What brilliant advice, you know. If you have, credit is not real money. Thank you for letting me. But this is really all it takes. It just takes a little bit of discipline. But this is what will happen when you're satisfied. Now, who do we look at in the dunya? Who did the Prophet ﷺ tell us to look at in the dunya? He said, look at those who are above you in piety, in religiosity, in taqwa, those who have better akhlaq. In other words, what's important? Those are the people who you try to be like. Because when you're following that path, and of course the ultimate person is the Prophet ﷺ, it's going to lead us to the ultimate path of what? Of Jannah. That's what we're trying to get to. That's the greatest blessing. You know, that's a place where you just eat for pleasure. You just drink for pleasure. But it's a struggle to get there. But that's the end goal. You know, the people of Jannah, it's really interesting. The people of Jannah, not Jahannam wa na'udhu billah. The people of Jannah are actually going to have a regret. They're actually going to have a regret. And their regret is going to be when they see all that they got. They're going to say, we wish we had worshipped Allah more. We wish we had done more tasbih. We wish we had read the Quran more or given more zakah, whatever it was, because of all that Allah gave us. So we're still going to have regret. May Allah make us all from the people of Jannah. Ameen. But just minimizing those regrets. So by following the people who are above us in religion and in deen, then inshallah ta'ala, this is what we can do. So this is our test. This is our test. How do we deal with the comforts? And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call us to account with easy reckoning. In fact, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call us to account بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, without any reckoning. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us blessings in our possessions. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who use our blessings for spreading greater good. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help our young people understand the true meaning of this life. رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين اللهم انصر إخواننا في كل مكان في كل مكان يا رب العالمين اللهم احفظ شباب المسلمين وبنات المسلمين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم ولذكر الله أولى وأعلى وأكبر وأقيم الصلاة